electromagnetic fields, electromagnetism, an overview. Last one of the three parts, series on electromagnetic field theory, lecture number 0.00. Electromagnetic field theory is also called field theory or wave theory in short. It is a core subject in electrical engineering. In fact, it is core of the core for the study of electrical engineering. The generation of electrical energy, its transmission, its distribution. All these aspects are based on electromagnetic field theory or wave theory. In communication engineering, the functioning of antenna, the design of antenna, it is all based on radiation, which is an important property of dynamic electromagnetic fields. One cannot imagine any wireless communication system without antennas. From this, it is not difficult to understand how much importance the electromagnetic field theory carries in communication engineering. Now, it is planned to give an overall view of electromagnetic field theory. This view is organized in three parts. The present session, that is last one, third one, we focus on various topics that are there, that are studied under time-varying fields and wave theory. Under time-varying fields, Maxwell's equations, retarded potentials, Poynting theorem, and some more important aspects are also covered. Under wave theory, wave equations, types of electromagnetic waves, uniform plane waves, wave polarization, and also reflection and refraction of wave. All these aspects are introduced. Now we move to second division and first part of the second division, time-varying fields. Before going further, it is required to be mentioned here that time-varying fields are fields. Surrounding conductors carrying time-varying currents are alternating currents. In these fields, there exists electric field, there exists magnetic field too. Therefore, time-varying fields are combination of electric field and magnetic field. Actually, it is an interconnection of electric field and magnetic field. The starting point of time-varying fields is Maxwell's equations. We start with Faraday's law, which says time-varying magnetic field is able to generate electric field. Then we move to Ampere-Maxwell's law, which says time-varying electric field is equivalent to magnetic field. Then continuity equation. What is continuity equation? We know pretty well, current is charge in motion. In circuit theory, that relation is indicated through I equal to dq by dt. This is single dimensional equation. It can be generalized to three dimensions. Once it is generalized, it appears as del dot j equal to minus dou rho by dou t. J is current, rho is charge density. This relation del dot j minus dou rho by dou t, it is continuity equation. The underlying principle of this equation is charge conservation. Charge can neither be created nor destroyed. Continuity equation also have integral form. Whatever is shown here, it is in differential form. It can be converted into integral form too. Then we move to retarded potentials. The concept of potential is the same as the concept we come across when electric scalar potential is introduced in electrostatics, when magnetic vector potential is introduced in study magnetic fields. Retarded potentials are potentials, potential functions that are defined, that are designed to work for time-varying fields. The expressions of these potentials involve certain amount of delay, time delay. Time delay is also called retardation. And for this reason, they are called retarded potentials. Then boundary conditions. Same. In fact, boundary conditions in time-varying fields, these are combination of time-varying fields studied in electrostatics and time-varying boundary conditions studied in study magnetic. Time-varying fields also, they have energy storage capability. As already mentioned, time varying fields are associated with electric field, time varying fields are associated with magnetic field. So electric field contains certain amount of energy, magnetic field contains certain amount of energy. So time varying fields contain two energies, electric energy and magnetic energy. In addition to that, a new feature is there in time varying fields, that is power flow. Power flow is specific to time varying fields. It doesn't exist in static fields. There is a theorem. It is called Poynting theorem. Poynting theorem is one which connects amount of energy that is stored, amount of power that is flowing, amount of power that is getting generated, amount of power that is being dissipated. It is an equation. It is based on energy conservation principle. Energy can neither be created nor destroyed. Poynting theorem comes into being when energy conservation principle is applied to electromagnetic fields. Before going further, it is also required to be mentioned, under time varying fields, we study four laws: Faraday's law, Ampere's law, Gauss law, and another law which describes divergence of magnetic fields. We consider these four laws and study them, try to understand the implications of these four laws under Maxwell's equations. Maxwell's equations have certain special, not ordinary special, but extraordinary special significance in electrical engineering. From Maxwell's equations, one can understand any electromagnetic phenomena whose frequency may be anywhere in between 0 and infinity, whose field intensity may be anywhere in between 0 and infinity, provided the system is linear. Maxwell, he combined these four equations into a set and was able to develop the theory of electromagnetism based on these four equations. Now, second part of the second division, EM waves. Starting point is derivation of wave equations. Dynamic electric field, dynamic magnetic field, they obey wave equations. It implies dynamic fields, they are associated with wave, traveling wave. Traveling wave is always associated with power flow. This power flow is called radiation. So wave equations, deriving wave equations are arriving at wave equations in electric field and in magnetic field implies the existence of radiation in dynamic fields. Several types of EM waves are there, broadly TEM and non-TEM. In TEM, again, plane waves, cylindrical waves, spherical waves are there. In non-TEM, TE waves are there, TM waves are there, TE plus TM, TM waves are there. All these waves are introduced under EM waves. Then we move to uniform plane waves. Uniform plane waves have certain special significance because we come across these waves frequently in wireless communication systems. In wireless communications, usually the transmitting antenna and receiving antenna, they are separated by large distances. Whatever may be the type of the wave at the transmitting antenna, by the time it reaches receiving antenna, it becomes uniform plane wave. So in a wireless communication system, at the receiving antenna, most of the times it is uniform plane wave. So roughly, nearly half of the times, we encounter uniform plane wave in the functioning of wireless communication system. Other types of waves, naturally, in the remaining 50% of the times. So, concept of uniform plane waves, it is introduced along with the properties and two quantities called depth of penetration and surface impedance. They are also studied or introduced under uniform planes. What is depth of penetration? When wave falls over a conductor, if it is a good conductor, the wave is able to penetrate only a small distance, very small. The distance it is able to enter into the conductor depends upon the conductivity. If the conductivity is very large, then only it can penetrate up to small depths. If conductivity is infinity, let us suppose the body is a perfect conductor, then the wave cannot enter. It cannot enter. If the body is of course, dielectric, then wave enters, travels further. Of course, an amount of wave also gets reflected. That's also there in case of dielectrics. Now, if you consider the case of a conducting material, conductor block, then there is a relation between the distance the wave enters into the block and the conductivity. That relation is quite an important aspect. The amount of depth the wave enters into the conductor is depth of penetration. Then surface impedance. When wave falls, currents flow because wave is associated with electric field. Electric field means potential. So this potential drives, or potential gradient drives certain currents. How much current flows, it depends upon the impedance of this block. That impedance determines the magnitude of currents. If the impedance is more, currents are going to be less. This impedance has certain special significance. This is called surface impedance. Then we move to polarization. We come across polarization already in the study of electrostatics. There it is dielectric polarization. Now it is wave polarization. Wave polarization refers to orientation of electric vector in the uniform plane wave. See, suppose a wave is traveling, uniform plane wave is traveling like this. Uniform plane wave is the electromagnetic wave. Electric vector exists, magnetic vector also exists. Sometimes the electric vector is vertical. Then we say this wave is vertically polarized. Sometimes the electric vector is horizontal. Then we say it is horizontally polarized. Sometimes we can find the electric vector rotating around the direction of propagation like this. Rotating. Okay. And this rotation of the electric vector may result in a circle. In such case, it is called circular polarization. It may result in an ellipse, then it is called elliptical polarization. Sometimes the electric vector rotates in clockwise, then it is called clockwise polarization. When it is rotating anti-clockwise, we call it anti-clockwise polarization. This clockwise, anti-clockwise, it is sense of polarization. They give the sense of polarization. So there are two types of broadly polarizations. One is linear polarization, horizontal, vertical, etc. These are examples for linear polarization. Circular, elliptical are examples for nonlinear polarization. Sense is associated with nonlinear. And then reflection and refraction. When wave falls over a body, let us suppose wave is traveling in free space, it is falling over a conductor body or a dielectric body, then what happens? It is found the behavior of the wave when it falls over a body is the same as the behavior of a light. Light undergoes reflection and refraction. Wave also undergoes reflection and refraction. Not only that, wave also obeys Snell's laws like light. There are two sets of Snell's laws. Snell's laws of reflection, Snell's laws of refraction. Light is analyzed, or its reflection and refraction is analyzed using Snell's laws. In the same way, as wave also obeys Snell's laws, we use these laws in the analysis of reflection and refraction. Here we consider two surfaces, conductor surface, dielectric surface. If we consider a conductor body, let us suppose it's a perfect conductor. When wave falls, it may be falling obliquely or it may be falling straight. In either case, what happens is, if it is perfect conductor body, then no wave enters into the body. Reason is, we know pretty well, inside a perfect conductor, electric field cannot exist. Electric field is zero. But electromagnetic wave means there must be electric field, there must be magnetic field. When electric field is zero, with zero electric field, how can an electromagnetic wave exist? Therefore, inside perfect conductor, wave cannot exist. So, entire incident wave gets reflected, of course, obeying Snell's laws of reflection. In case of dielectric, if it is a perfect dielectric, let us say perfect dielectric, then the incident wave partly enters into the dielectric, refraction happens, partly it gets reflected, reflection exists. But in either case, the reflected wave obeys Snell's laws of reflection, the refracted wave obeys Snell's laws of refraction. One more point also required to be mentioned here. in the analysis of wave reflection and refraction, we consider the polarization. We consider a horizontally polarized wave as incident wave. Then we consider a vertically polarized wave as incident wave for the analysis. So polarization of the wave is taken into consideration. It is also taken into account while doing the analysis. This is the difference between analysis of light, which we did in the intermediate, and the analysis of the wave, which we do in electromagnetic field theory. We consider normal incidence, we consider oblique incidence, we consider conductor surface, we consider dielectric surface, we consider polarization. After taking all those things into account, reflection and refraction of the wave is done. These are the things that are associated in the study and analysis of electromagnetic field theory or electromagnetic wave theory. This is third and last part of the three-part series on overview to electromagnetism. Hope you have a wonderful, beautiful, enriching learning experience. Enough for now. See you again soon.